Nos vamos deslizando por la ciencia, no solamente acumulando conocimientos, sino basándonos en miles de soñadores que piensan en aquellas cosas que hasta hace muy poquito resultaban imposibles. Ya en el año 2013, en el entorno de una conferencia internacional llamada 2045, conocí a un montón de soñadores entre los que se encontraban Ray Kurzweil, que habló del destino de la humanidad, Stuart Hameroff sobre la conciencia, todo ello amparado bajo el paraguas del millonario Dmitry Itzkov. Pero ahí también pude encontrarme con Nigel Ackland, un inglés que es poseedor de una de las prótesis más avanzadas del mundo, la Bionic 3, fabricada en fibra de carbono y aluminio, que se activa con parte de su musculatura y que pretendían ya en aquel entonces activarla con su pensamiento. Pero el tiempo no ha pasado en vano y hoy os vamos a presentar uno de los mayores adelantos a la hora de controlar nuestro entorno mediante el cerebro. Para ello nos encaminamos a través de la maraña del sistema de metro de Nueva York hasta el Hospital Mount Sinai, fundado en 1853 y de intensa fama internacional, nombrado como número uno no solamente en Estados Unidos, sino en el resto del mundo.
Me encuentro en la 103, en la calle 103, a la altura de Central Park, pero prácticamente al lado del Mount Sinai. Voy a ver al Dr. Mahidi y vamos a ver qué es lo que nos va a explicar acerca de, bueno, este tratamiento revolucionario que realmente puede cambiar la vida de cientos o millones, a lo mejor, de personas a lo largo de todo el mundo. Vamos a ello. Este edificio que tengo justamente detrás mío y las siguientes tres manzanas es nada menos que el complejo hospitalario de Mount Sinai en Nueva York, uno de los mayores templos de la ciencia y de la medicina a nivel mundial. En la reunión secreta vamos a profundizar en lo que consideramos quizá uno de los mayores avances de las últimas décadas y que os iremos contando.
El hospital, como gran parte de los grandes hospitales a nivel mundial, es un laberinto, un entresijo de edificios, pasillos y puentes que con mucha facilidad puedes llegar a perderte. El profesor Shahram Mahidi parecía ocultarse en las entrañas del hospital, pero gracias a una recepcionista, casada además con un gallego español, sirvió de cicerone para lograr encontrar finalmente el pasillo y la localización exacta. El doctor Mahidi, de origen iraní, de hecho estudió medicina justamente en la Universidad de Teherán, es profesor de neurocirugía en el Mount Sinai. Y quizás por ese compañerismo entre médicos, el doctor Mahidi se comportó de una forma tremendamente amable desde el primer momento.
If something emergency calls or something happens, we can interrupt it, right? Because you're gonna edit that later.
Yes, yes, yes.
This is not like a live program.
No, we are not live program.
Because I have done some live here in this room. That's a little more stressful.
I totally understand. Okay. Well, Dr. Mahidi, first of all, thank you, for giving us this interview. It's very nice from you, and we are very impressed of what you have done, but I would like that you tell it to us in your own words.
Thank you very much for having me. So this was a scientific breakthrough, obviously for us. To implant the first endovascular brain-computer interface in the United States last month.
Has this technique, has it been done somewhere else in the world at this same high level?
The device that we used is called Stentrode. designed and by a company called Synchron, which was developed by my friend and colleague, Dr. Thomas Oxley. He started this groundbreaking research more than a decade ago in Australia, and eventually developed this device to be used in humans. And eventually last year, FDA approved this device to be used within the clinical trial for safety and efficacy in the US patients. So that's how then we started enrolling patients here.
I've read that it's the first FDA investigational device exception study to evaluate a permanently implanted PCI. What does it mean, a device exception? Do you know that?
The device at this time is not approved by FDA to be used outside the clinical trial. This is only to be used within clinical trial setting to ascertain its safety and feasibility in the US population. After this phase of the trial, which will include 6 patients, then we will expand it to a larger clinical trial of efficacy in the United States.
How many patients do you have the implant right now in the States?
In the United States, only one patient had the implant, which was last month. Now we are in process of actively enrolling subsequent subjects. It is a clinical trial of evaluating the safety and feasibility of endovascular brain-computer interface stent road in 6 patients with severe paralysis.
What kind of paralysis do they show? What's the etiology?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So, paralysis can be caused by a wide range of etiologies, right? Stroke, trauma, spinal cord injuries, and some congenital disorders or motor neuron disorders. So there is a subset of patients with paralysis who maintain their thinking process and their brain function is still intact. However, the connection between the command center in the brain and the end organ, which are the limbs or sometimes the speech area, are disconnected because of the injury, which could be from ALS, could be from spinal cord injury, or from multiple sclerosis locked-in syndrome from basilar stroke. So in this patient, when you do a brain MRI or functional MRI, you see that the motor cortex maintain its functional capacity. However, it's unable to transfer the command and signal to perform the task that it is thinking of. So these patients are a candidate for this trial, because what the brain-computer interface does essentially capture the signals from the brain and then transfer that to the computer, and then we decode that and then connect it to certain computer commands to operate digital devices.
I can understand, and for example, in the lateral sclerosis, but in cord injury, person usually can speak or can communicate. No.
Well, yes, in high cervical cord injuries, yes, patient can speak, communicate, but in severe cord injury, they are unable to operate their digital devices because they are completely paralyzed in a severe form. So although they can speak, but they cannot operate, let's say, home devices or their computer, they cannot send an email or do online shopping, like or text a friend. What this platform can help them do is to enable them to basically use the digital devices and perform tasks such as sending a text or sending an email or communicating with the caregiver.
How long does the procedure takes about?
Well, the procedure has two parts. One is the endovascular part of the procedure when we go inside the internal jugular vein and navigate the catheter up to the superior sagittal sinus, and then under careful monitoring and navigation, we deploy the stent in the superior sagittal sinus next to the motor cortex. And the second part of the procedure is when we have to create a pocket in the chest to place the internal receiver device and connect the wire to it, which will be underneath the skin.
It's a bit like the pacemaker.
Exactly.
Or the reservoirs for chemotherapy that are put, implanted in the chest.
Somehow. Exactly.
Like that. No, with the line that is connected.
Very similar. So in pacemaker, the wire going down to the heart, but here our lead wire is going up to the brain.
To the brain.
Very similar to that. So the entire procedure altogether takes a couple of hours, something between 3 to 5 hours, depending on the steps that we take.
Under general anesthesia?
Definitely under general anesthesia, yes.
Professor, can you show us, please, the device?
Oh yeah, this is the
stent rod.
This is a sample of the device that we have here.
It's of course very tiny. Obviously, yeah. I didn't expect something bigger because it goes in the brain, no? But still.
So yeah, this is the stent, which actually has, when it is fully expanded, it can go up to 8 millimeter in the diameter, and its length, the full length is 40 millimeter.
40 millimeters.
And as you see, it continues by this lead wire, which will extend down to the transverse sinus jugular vein, and then all the way down to the internal receiver.
What are these in the chest little spots that are in the net?
Yeah, the stent has 16 electrodes, which are implanted within the stent. This is part of the stent design, and they are capturing the signals from the brain and transferring them to the computer.
You link them?
The signal to specific computer tasks, such as right click, left click, or moving the cursors and doing different tasks. So there's a range of movements and tasks that you can ask the patient to do. And obviously that also expanding as we move towards next generations of the device.
After what you have explained me, what's the potential in future?
Field for us. So now we have this neuroendovascular brain computer interface, which is opening actually a completely new field, which in coming years you're gonna see it's gonna include neuromodulation, have some application in treatment of depression, movement disorders, intractable seizures. So we can see that where technology will take us from this very first step. So it's going to be very exciting to see how this very young field will evolve in a decade to come. So it is a telemetry monitoring, a telemetry unit. So this is a 75 centimeter lead wire.
Yes.
At the end, it goes into the telemetry unit. You screw it there, lock it there, and then suture it.
You do the whole thing in the same operation?
It has to be done all in the same operation. Okay. And when the surgery is done, everything is just under its skin and inside the vessel. You do all in the same session. And the end of the wire is connected to this telemetry unit, and which will capture the signals, and that from that will be transferred to the computer.
And for example, how is the first patient nowadays, the one you operate in July?
The patient is doing very well. The surgery went very well, and we were able to send him home within 2 days after the procedures, and everything went as expected. And we are very excited about that.
Does this patient suffer atrophic lateral sclerosis?
Or? Correct. This patient was an ALS patient with ALS. Severe quadriplegia.
I think probably this is one of the important difference between this project, you know, important project, and the Neuralink of Elon Musk. I think compared in all the medical literature, you know, with the Neuralink of Elon Musk, it's more invasive, it's less invasive. Or what do you think are the differences?
I think the difference falls into the fact that I mentioned before, just being minimally invasive, not violating the brain anatomy and going intravascular make it a big advantage in this scenario. But it is good to have a lot of effort from different angles to look into this big problem in medicine. We are all working very hard to help some of our sickest and more disabled patients. Overall, the outcome is going to be just expanding our understanding and knowledge of this and helping our patients.
Fantastic. Well, Professor Mahidi,
thank you very much for this great interview.
Yeah,
thank you. I think the timing worked very well, and I can go downstairs and do the surgery.
Y de esta manera concluyó nuestra entrevista con el Dr. Shahram Mahidi para I Love My Brain. Doctor, fue recogiendo cuidadosamente el dispositivo tan delicado que prácticamente tenía una textura que parecía quebrarse con la mirada. Yo, por otro lado, comencé a recoger otro tipo de aparatos también que me ayudaron a hacer esta entrevista. Pero mientras tanto, multitud de ideas también bullían en mi cabeza y seguramente también en la del Dr. Mahidi. Siempre pensamos que este tipo de dispositivos de tratamientos revolucionarios van a servir a otras personas. Pero cuidado, quizás, y ojalá que no, nos sirvan a nosotros mismos.